Welcome to part 9 in this new tutorial series where I'm looking at getting better pictures with your Panasonic Lumix Bridge Cameras. Now, first of all, apologies for the low level of lighting in this particular tutorial, as I don't want the ambient lighting to affect the flash pictures that we're going to create today. There is a way around that, but that will be for a later section in the video. But I just started off with a low level light so we can actually use flash and get some true images rather than it being influenced by the ambient light. So, today we're going to start shooting with our cameras and with, first of all, the pop-up flash. And I'm going to be using, first of all, the FZ200, which is ideal for these type of studio macro shots. You can get fairly close with the lens of this camera, even without using supplementary lenses. And it's ideal for this sort of work. You get good resolution and good tonal range. So we've got the FZ200, and basically I've got it set up in aperture priority mode with f4.5, and my ISO is 200. Shooting in the standard photo style, just straight zeros across the board without any adjustment to sharpness or noise reduction. So the first picture I'm going to take is of this little doll here against a black background. I'm just going to use the pop-up flash, so I'm going to enable that now by just sliding the switch to the side, and that brings up the pop-up flash. I can view on the back of the screen what the exposure will be, and you notice that it's going to be, it's 1/60th of a second, which is what the camera would set for flash, and my aperture is 4.5. So the lens will be focusing the image on the sensor, and then the flash will reflect light from the subject back into the sensor, and that will be governing the amount of light by using the TTL exposure. So we're going to take that shot and we can have a look at it. Don't need to use a self timer because we're using flash with a very fast duration, so we won't get any subject motion blur anyway. You can see that that image is actually merging into the background. This doll has got quite a dark brown hair, and we're shooting against the background, so that will actually merge into the background. If we were to use a white background, and if I just hold this card behind the subject so that we've got a contrast, if I were to take that picture again, just try to get it in the same position. Everything's mirrored back to front because I'm looking in two displays. You can see in that shot that the hair is actually standing out from the background. But I want to take this picture against the black background so that it's emphasizing the model. But again, we're using direct on-camera flash, and that creates these heavy shadows. So what I'm going to use is the diffuser that I showed you in part one, and that's just this dimple plastic diffuser which slides into the hot shoe like so. Make sure it's pushed all the way to the front so you're getting maximum distance between the flash head and the diffuser so that you're getting a maximum light spread. And now I'll take that picture again and you can see the difference. We should be seeing some softer shadows under a chin because the light's coming from above. And don't forget, if you are using flash, always remove your lens HUD, otherwise you'll have shadows in the lower part of your picture because it's shielded from the flash head in the lower bottom. So the more you extend the lens, the more that shadow will progress into your image. So always remove your lens HUD when you're shooting flash. So that's the first shot we've done. But what I want to do now is introduce some reflector so that I can bring some light onto her hair so it separates it from the background. And to do that, you just have to be a little bit ingenious. And I've just got a little table tripod here, which I can stand on the bench. And I've got a white foam board card, so I can just clip that in position and put it in position so it's catching some of the light from the flash, and make sure that it's not in the image. So I'm just going to have to adjust that a little bit further up like so. And it's just out of shot, so the light from the flash will go rebound off the white card and throw some light onto her hair at the top, and that should improve the separation of that dark hair against the black background. So just have a look at that. Still not giving me the separation I wanted. So what I'm going to do now is increase the flash power. So if I go into the menu, I'm working back to front again, but I'll go into the menu and I need to be in the flash adjust, so I can go backwards and go into flash adjust, cursor to the right, and I'm going to put a 1 f-stop of light more onto the flash. So this is flash exposure compensation, not exposure compensation that you'd use for ambient light. So this is flash exposure adjust. Press set to lock that in place, and you notice on the screen it shows we've got plus one exposure compensation for the flash. So now the flash will fire with more intensity, and if I do that, and see, it's a little bit brighter. Just trying to angle this card a little bit further down, so it's just out of shot, but catching enough spill light from the flash so it will come back. So we'll reshoot that. And that looks better in this display. Remember, I'm just using single area autofocus, and that's set up by either using the side focus button, which allows me to position the focus point. I can use the back control dial to change the size of it. So I'm going to make it smaller and center that over one of the eyes to make sure that we've got the eyes in focus, which is critical in portraits. So now we've got the position set. We'll take that again. Well, we've seen how we can use the on-camera pop-up flash of the FZ200 with the diffuser panel in place to capture some pretty good images of this little model. And we used the white reflector to bounce a little bit of light back onto the hair to separate it from my black background. But now I want to look at using an external flash gun in the optical slave mode. Now you can use something like the Nissan i40 in the slave digital mode, which eliminates the pre-flash, or you could use the Godox TT350. This is the old version for the Olympus Panasonic range, and again you can use that in the S2 mode, so it will eliminate that pre-flash that the TTL generates from the camera. So first of all, you can see the setup I've got here, and if I just slightly zoom out, you can see I've got the i40 set up on a little tripod, so I can project the light down onto the top of the model to highlight the hair in this particular scene. So it's set up in the slave digital mode. That's the way that you set the i40 up for slave flash. And again, I've got the Panasonic set up exactly as we had for the original with the white background. So I'm going to take that picture, and you can see that the light is being projected from the flash onto the hair, and it illuminates it much better than your white bounce card. So let's take that first shot and have a look at that in the video. You can see on the top of the model, we've now got those nice catch lights. You have to set the power manually, and with the i40, you can go down to 1/256th power. So that's ideal if you're going to use these flashes at close range. If you want to reduce the flash power even more, you can bring out the diffuser panel and put it into the 24mm end, and that will diffuse the light a little bit more and reduce its power. So that is using the slave flash to illuminate the top of the model to give you that hair light for separation. Now, we talked earlier about using a gelled flash to give you coloured backgrounds, and that's what I've got here. I've got the TT350O, and I've got that set also in the optical slave mode. So if I just turn this on, I've got the power set to 1/8, and I'm in the S2 slave digital mode. So again, that precludes the slave flash. Turn the head around so that the transparent window of the Godox flash is actually in line with the flash because you're using optical and it's line of sight. So again, I'm going to project this light onto the background to give us that nice background halo effect. It's going to be trial and error as to where the light will go, but I'm going to try it in this position. So again, with the flash power set to 1/8 on the TT350 and 1/256th on the i40, and we're using the pop-up flash in its TTL mode, let's take the shot and have a look where the highlight is on the back panel. That's a little bit high, so I'm going to aim it down a little bit more. And down just a little bit more. I want that bright halo immediately behind the head. So I'll just go down a little bit more. One more. That looks better. So that's how you can gel that up. The TT350 has got the panel diffuser in again, so I've put that down to reduce its power and spread the light a little bit more. These are gels, which come as a kit, again on Amazon, very cheap. Get a whole set of colored gels and this holder. You normally put around a Velcro band around the flash head, but you find that's probably too big for the TT350, or it's designed for the larger flashes like the 685 or bigger. So I just tend to put these in place with an elastic band. Remember to keep the flap away from the optical panel at the front so that you're not precluding the light from hitting the sensor to give you the triggering. So there's some ideas how you can do some tabletop pictures with the FZ200. Because it's a basic TTL flash, you need to be a little bit creative if you want to create more dynamic pictures. Well, the sun has actually came out. It's still quite cold and quite breezy here in the UK, but I'm going to try and get some pictures for you using the Godox radio triggering system with the FZ1000. So we can actually see how we can use that to create even better pictures against the light or using it as a fill flash, whichever mode we want to use for our particular type of photography. So let me set that up and we'll go outside and take some pictures. Well, that's it for part 9 of this tutorial series, where we've been looking at using flash with the Panasonic Lumix Bridge cameras. Now, I hope you found some of those techniques useful and you can adopt them for your own particular photographic needs. Now, in the final part of this video series, I'll be shooting video and showing you how to set up your cameras to provide you with good video from the FZ200 all the way up to the FZ2500. That will probably take place on the Isle of Mull, so I'm off there next week, so hopefully you'll be able to see some pictures of Mull itself and get an idea of how fantastic that island is purported to be. I haven't been there yet, so it's going to be a new adventure for me as well. So until then, thanks again for watching, and again, if you are a new viewer, please do click that subscribe button and the bell notification icon, and then you'll be notified when I upload that final video in this series. Also check out my photographic blog, and I'll put a link to that in the video description below. You'll find lots more information about Panasonic Lumix Bridge cameras and in Micro Four Thirds systems and the APS-C Canon cameras as well. So I hope you'll check that out. So until that next video, thanks very much for watching. Please do take care, and I'll see you on the next one. Goodbye for now.